Hello, I'm Dr. April Massey, Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences, and your host for a new series, Talking Arts and Sciences. Over the course of this series, you will hear the candid and unscripted insights of experts involved in arts and sciences programming and activities that allow University of the District of Columbia students to aspire, accomplish, and take on the world. This episode focuses on the art form spoken word. Joining me is Dr. Matthew Petti, a creative writing professor in the University of the District of Columbia's English program, and my special guest, Ms. Elizabeth Acevedo. Ms. Acevedo is a writer, performance artist, and educator. She holds a Bachelor of Arts in Performing Arts from the George Washington University and a Master of Fine Arts in Creative Writing from the University of Maryland. She has been a featured performer on BET, Moondose, and she has delivered several TED Talks. She has graced stages nationally and internationally, including renowned venues such as the Lincoln Center, Madison Square Garden, the Kennedy Center for the Performing Arts, and South Africa's State Theater. Ms. Acevedo is the District of Columbia's 2016 Women of the World Poetry Slam representative. Ms. Acevedo joined a distinguished roster of writers in residence here at the University of the District of Columbia this past spring. At the end of our most recent academic year, Ms. Acevedo's students performed at Washington, D.C.'s flagship Busboys and Poets. Here is one of the performances.
This poem is an ode to words. Words are an art form, and as a wannabe writer, it gives me life to become a voice in an age of screaming and dying, being and then lying, loving and fighting. Writing on my hands and my arms and these pages, I want to help it live. I want to give it life, just as it does me. I want to help it breathe to stop your breath. Can you see between the lines, the distance between my eyes and the page? I stay glued and attached to my own ideas, a love of my own, like a mother who can't let her child stay out of her sight. I want to raise this art form. I want to raise it high above my head. I want to raise it from the dead, because it's not dead. It's very much alive. And it's coming, and it's in our ears and coming out of our mouths. And I eat, sleep, live words. They fascinate me, these endless tools to make ourselves heard, their power taking off like birds with golden wings, flying and blinding us with a glint from the sun. They hold my future close to the stars, in a galaxy of fantastic creations, from books for years to the smallest implications of feelings and things, like welcome home, a cocoon, a cacophony, transformed into the sweetest symphony, the sweetest music I've ever heard. In its simplest form, it's a word.
Yeah.
Dr. Petti, I want to start off with you. You've been actively working to build a creative writing program at the University of the District of Columbia for a couple of years now. Tell the audience about your vision for what the program can be and how you see it influencing the lives of not just English majors, but other students who aspire to write. Can you talk about that just a bit?
Yeah, because I teach both the creative writing classes and the composition classes, and it's really been for about 10 years now that we've been doing the creative writing in the English department. And one of the things, because it's a great interest of mine, but one of the things that I notice is that students who take these creative writing classes feel freer to express themselves than they do in more academic kinds of writing classes. So what we're really attempting to do is to have students who are interested in writing careers express themselves in that way, but also students who just want to be creative to help some of their academic writing be able to have that experience. We noticed that the class was extremely popular, always filled, and so we ended up expanding to an advanced creative writing class as well. And from there, we were able to get a writer in residence that's been supported by College of Arts and Sciences, and that's been a really popular program, and Elizabeth, probably our most popular instructor.
Okay, no pressure there,
don't
huh?
Don't tell me anything.
So Ms. Acevedo, I want to welcome you again. It's good seeing you again. Talk to us a bit about your UDC experience. Mm-hmm. And then I want you to walk us back to you as a budding young writer and how that person became the Elizabeth Acevedo that we now know.
I was so excited to receive an invitation to be the writer in residence, and that it was specifically targeted towards spoken word, because I think a lot of times you'll find that in academia there tends to be this looking down upon spoken word in the classroom, or you know, any type of performance in the creative writing classroom. And so for me, it felt like such a welcoming space to say, let's build this new kind of course together, and let's see how do you teach a craft writing workshop that is also thinking about performance. And so it was an experiment on my end. I've never taken a spoken word class, right? And so now to be teaching one, it was kind of like, what are the things my students need to know to be strong writers and strong presenters? And so it was an incredible opportunity that it came from UDC. I think that there's something real trailblazing happening to be thinking about literature in the classroom being expansive. And in terms of my own backgrounds, I mean, I went to the George Washington University knowing I wanted to be a spoken word artist, or knowing I wanted to perform. And the major didn't exist there, right? They had a creative writing minor at the time. They had theater. And I met with the dean of the theater department. I said, I might have to transfer out because I can't find what I want. And she said, well, let's build it. And so the performing arts major is a special interdisciplinary major. No one else has the curriculum I had because I made it up. And so I like borrowed from that, you know, those courses when trying to come up with this course. So it was great, kind of full circle, to be teaching what I always wanted to learn.
So you're a perfect example of what an arts and sciences dean hopes that the liberal arts does for a student. It allows you the freedom to pursue your passion, believing and understanding that a career will come. So talk a little bit about the freedom that you must have had in terms of conversation with your parents and just believing that you had the right to pursue the artist in you and that the other pieces would come together. How did you, as a 17, 18-year-old kid, kind of have the freedom intellectually, emotionally, to know that that could be okay?
I think it was really important that I had always had educators in my life that were very supportive, who saw something special and said, you can and probably should pursue this. And my parents, being immigrants, I was first generation college student, they had very particular ideas about what you go off to college to do, right? And even going off was a big deal. You know, no one in my neighborhood left my neighborhood. And so for them, they were like, you're going all the way to DC to study poetry and how to present poetry. And so it was, I think, my really believing that this is where I felt my best self, where it felt like I was really grappling with the world and trying to understand and create change, and that I was really dedicated to what I felt when I walked on stage. I mean, I still get nervous before every show, but there's something so beautiful about facing that fear, and that is what I commit to, is saying, this is scary, but let me do it anyways. And that, you know, even dedicating myself to the career was scary, but it was kind of like, that fear is going to make me better in all aspects, not just as a performer, but as a person. When you face your fear every day, there's something powerful there.
So you've taken that power and you've built an amazing platform for your artistry, but you're also an amazing educator and an activist. And so you've used your platform far broader than, and I don't mean that in any way to diminish the art form, but you've built other opportunities around your talent as an artist. And I think that I want you to respond to that. But Matt, I also want you to think about, for the students that we serve, I think that that's an important vehicle and opportunity. And I want you to talk a little bit about whether or not students know that that's what they want to do with this, or it evolves as they're in the process. So could you talk a little bit about just your opportunities in terms of in the classroom, stages around the country as an activist, using your artistry to put before audiences topics that are somewhat uncomfortable sometimes?
Yeah.
So can you talk about that?
It's been fascinating. I mean, I tour the entire country and the world, and I go to spaces that aren't always open to some of the things that I'm bringing up, whether it's talking about race or gender or, you know, culture, language. I bring up things that I know make people uncomfortable. Mm-hmm. And I think the performance itself can be used as an educational tool, because all of a sudden audiences are faced with a body and a person that they may not always interact with, and they sit and they listen, and so they're taking in this very personal experience. And I try to always bring in a workshop if I can, if a school is open to it, because there's something about talking at people, and then they're saying, now let's have a conversation. What is the story you have to tell? Okay. And I think that there's something really important that, I don't know if I would consider myself an activist necessarily. I'm interested in the stories that people have to tell and understand fully that, like, the personal is political, mm-hmm. and that this is the only way that we'll learn to speak to each other is by fully committing to understanding the stories. Mm-hmm. And maybe there's an activist role in that, but that's not my goal.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think, I guess I would say that I was not as courageous as Elizabeth was when I was going to school. I was thinking, two things I really love, one is psychology and one is writing. And I knew that I could not make my, you know, make money writing. So I decided to pursue psychology, got a doctorate. You know, my first half of my life was like that. And then finally, in my 40s, said, I really miss this writing, and ended up getting an MFA, and then was lucky enough to land a job here. And I think we've got about your question about students, I think some of them really do feel similarly, probably to both of us, that, gee, this is my passion, can I really make it work? And I think, you know, sometimes we give our students the direction that they can follow their dreams, and sometimes we give students the direction that, well, you need to be, you know, practical about all of this. And then for other students, they know they like to write, but they never thought it was that other people would like to hear what they write. And so then they get the support that a creative writing class offers. And we've been able to place several students in MFA programs after coming through the creative writing program here. So I think for some it develops. Some of us are a little too shy to say, yeah, we want to call ourselves artists. Mm-hmm. I know you even do a little poetry that you...
I do.
So, I don't know if that answers your question.
It does, and it leads me to another. For the art form spoken word, is that a poet? Is it a form of poetry? Mm-hmm. Is it a form of creative writing? Is it not able to be, to put space around it and say that it's something? Can it be any of a number of things that feed any of a number of creative opportunities that dwell here and that connect with something out there? Can you guys speak to that? Because when you look at, just trying to get a definition, mm-hmm. you know, it's kind of all over the map,
it
and
is.
People are very clear that it's this, but it's not this, but at the center of it, it's creative writing. Beyond that, what is it?
It was funny when we were talking about teaching this course, I kept saying it's going to be a craft course. I'm teaching them the way I would teach any course of writing poetry. The difference is that we will also be considering, now that it's written, how do you elevate it off the page? Okay. And it, maybe that is the only definitive answer I can give that others okay. might not agree with, is that spoken word does take into account that there is an audience. And I don't think when you're writing that that is what you're doing. You're just writing the poem. But when the poem is done, then you say, okay, how does it sound? How is it going to be presented? Where is there a strategic place for me to slow down or increase my volume or use my hands? That once the poem is done, you layer on performance.
Okay.
But it is essentially a poet that is also considering their body. Maybe that's the way that I can conceptualize it.
Okay. Yeah, and for me, and I'm certainly, I don't know the spoken word part like you do. For me, I think of when a person is writing a poem, that there's a kind of like almost building on the page concreteness about it, as opposed to spoken word, mm-hmm. where there's really, like you say, you're using your body and your voice. A poem can work both on the stage and on the page as well. I guess I would also say that spoken word has brought poetry back to popularity.
Mm-hmm.
I think that you know, if you were going to say, okay, we're going to have a poetry reading, how many people are going to show up at a venue that we're having poetry readings every week? You just don't get that audience.
No.
And spoken word really has brought an audience back to poetry.
I'm always fascinated by the poetry is dead conversation that
comes
up every couple of years, and then I'm looking online and I'm like, there are poetry videos that have millions of views. There are kids who memorize poems after poems of their favorite, you know, and I just think, and it's not in the classroom, it's not, you know, considered part of the mainstream, but it's happening. We're engaging with poetry, I think, more than perhaps 20, 30, 40 years ago on a level of just videos and finding your favorite poets.
That's right. I agree.
So for UDC's creative writing program, where do we go? We saw an amazing response to the class that you just taught. We saw students who found more than voice, they found power in participating in the class and standing on that stage.
Mm-hmm.
So what does that mean for us as an institution in terms of what we want creative writing to be able to do? How we make decisions from semester to semester about what the creative writing class looks like, who leads it, what that means long term for our students.
Yeah, your question makes me remember, I think it's at Yale University where they require their engineering students to take creative writing classes, just because it gets a different part of the brain working. In terms of where we want to go with it, I mean, I think we've done a nice job of bringing different genres to the students. So we've had writers who write novels, we've had poets, we've had memoirists, and now spoken word artists. And I think that there are students in the university who would be interested in writing children's books, for instance, or young adult literature. So any of those kinds of things where we can support students' creative efforts in writing, I think we want to pursue. I have a dream of, you know, an MFA program someday at UDC. There are currently, as far as I know, no MFA creative writing programs in historically black colleges and universities. So we'd be pioneering in that way as well. But I'm a biased person. I think creative writing is good for everyone.
Yeah. I agree. I mean, and I think that probably there is a creative writer that dwells in each of us and that lives in now in an iPad, but before on an old notepad or a journal, if you were fortunate enough to have that. But I think we all scribble and doodle and or in our heads even, we write. Even if it never makes it to the page, I think that our conversations in that inner space in the head, that it kind of feeds the soul on different levels. I mean, and I don't think people maybe capture it as that, but I think it's an important part of existence for many of us. And I hope that people now kind of occupying themselves with the ever-ready cell phone doesn't take the place of the space that used to be kind of your private, in your head writing space. It was important for me, I think, always. And I don't know if that's what you guys ever do or ever think about, or if your writing was always from thought to page, or if there is a space, an inner space, where some of your writing dwells.
Right. I mean, I always say to students that, you know, when you living in life, you art is allows you to transcend experience. So that, you know, if you can create art, you can transcend whatever you go through in life, whether that's writing or dancing or singing or drawing or you're taking your experience and rather than being victimized by it, you are transcending it, making something out of it. And so I think it allows us to do that, and that's important to feel human for all of us. Otherwise, you feel like a part of the machine, and that doesn't feel good.
Right.
And how important it is to process. And I think we see that a lot of, and I work with students on all capacities, don't know how to grapple with what they deal with or what they feel. And the moment I like ask them a very strategic question and tell them to write, it's them telling themselves a story. It's them telling themselves, how do I feel? They don't know until they have to start documenting what is it that I'm thinking or I feel. And that, how pivotal is that to have a tool all of a sudden to help you make sense of experiences that don't make sense sometimes.
Right, right. That's such an interesting thing, because we sort of think about writing as you think of something, then you write it down. But if you can get into the practice of just writing without thinking, things that come out really surprise you, and that surprising thing is very, you know, really rewarding.
Right. So how does that start, that you're just writing without thinking?
You have to undo the training that you've gotten from school, which is think before you speak, think before you write. If you don't think before you write, what comes out is often, wow, where'd that come from? Right. Oh, that's how I feel.
I think we see it all the time. I mean, when you're teaching composition and you have students that write a whole essay and they get to the end and they're like, oh, that's my thesis. I have to rewrite the whole thing. It's that writing is thinking.
Right.
Right, and there's all these studies that have been done that it's we don't think before we write. We
right.
might have an idea, but through the writing we arrive
right.
at what it is we were trying to get at. And that moment of discovery, once you train yourself to look for it, I think, you know, is really rewarding. And you now know, like, this, it's okay if this doesn't make sense because I'm arriving to where it will.
We're about out of time, but I do have one question that I want you to both answer, and I think you'll come at it from very different perspectives. In academic writing, you don't necessarily have to have a high level of trust in your instructor. You know, they know how to write better than you. You believe that, and they're going to tell you what you didn't do right. You know, there are grammatical errors. But in creative writing, there's a level of trust that you've got to have in the person that's shepherding you through that class. How do you come at helping to establish those bonds with your students?
I think a lot about classroom culture before I enter the classroom. Okay. It's one of the big things, and maybe because I taught middle school and that's really emphasized at that grade level, but I've carried it with me to the university experience because a lot of these poems are very personal.
Right.
There's not this idea yet of the poet and the speaker. Often I see, especially with beginner courses, it's me, and this is what happened, right? And the truth is what matters. And so I have to be very aware of sensitivity and letting them know that whatever you write, whatever the draft is, like, it's safe here, and I will take care of it. I'm going to make it better, but that I also try to be very aware of not tearing down a poem to make it better, right? Finding what's already good there.
Right, classroom culture, absolutely crucial. We talk about classroom culture before we start the class. Mm-hmm. We talk about support before. Don't even want to call it criticism. What doesn't work for me? But support first, and there are studies that show that support for creative writing yields better results than sort of negative criticism. But that's the job of the instructor, to create a classroom culture where it feels safe, because it is very personal. Mm-hmm. And we work very hard to say, look, everyone's opinion is the same. You know, I have an opinion, but your all opinion is just as valuable. So I'll disagree with students and it'll be okay.
I want to thank both of you. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you.
Matthew, it's always a pleasure.
Thanks.
I hope you come back to us and teach
thank
again
you.
Because the students are so buzzing about it. So thank you. Yeah, your enthusiasm is just infectious, as is yours. Thank you
Thanks.
Very much.
Thank you so much.
If you would like more information about the academic programs and events offered by the University of the District of Columbia College of Arts and Sciences, please visit us at www.udc.edu. Thank you for watching. I'm Dr. April Massey, Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences at the University of the District of Columbia. Your dream, our guidance.
Okay, so I wrote this last night, so bear with me. This is called A Black Mother's Testimony. Don't sit up there and judge me until you've had to strip your 16-year-old daughter down to her bare, shivering skin and try to wash away the stench of diverted shame from every gland and every pore, back hunched, head hung, tears rushing down the shower drain like a river that's been disturbed. She said no. She said, Mom, I said no. See, I taught my daughter from a very young age that the word no stands on its own, that the word no seeks no apologies because it gives no permission, that the word no commands attention, breeds in respect, and exhales bravery. So you tell me. Tell me, how do I explain to my daughter, as I watch her brick-built layers of skin that I've worked for 16 years to keep strong, weather into tiny particles of dirt? Tell me, how do I explain to her that in a yes-privileged society, that the word no holds no weight because it is the hung elephant in the room that mice ignore? Tell me, how do I explain to her that while I was teaching her the power of no's, someone was neglecting to teach her son the difference between consent and refusal? That someone else was growing their son up to be her walking contradiction? How do I tell her that in the eyes of this fucked up world, that her body does not belong to her? That her limbs are merely extensions from broken roots? That her mouth is just an accessory on her body to be seen and not heard? That the system wasn't built to uplift, but rather oppress? That she will be stoned by the biggest sinners? That no matter how hard she tries, no matter how hard I try, that there is no guarantee that her history will not repeat itself? When you can answer those questions, Your Honor, then you will understand why I killed that son of a bitch. Yeah.